Random House Audio presents American Creation, Triumphs and Tragedies at the Founding of the Republic by Joseph J. Ellis. Read for you by John H. Mayer. Foreword. The question that prompted this book first struck my mind in the fall of 2000. I was on a book tour for Founding Brothers, making presentations that happened to coincide with the presidential election and the subsequent vote-counting controversy in Florida. One question that came up at every stop concerned the Electoral College. How in heaven's name did the founders invent such a weird contraption? The other predictable question was more plaintive. Why must we choose between Al Gore and George W. Bush, whereas American voters 200 years ago could choose between John Adams and Thomas Jefferson? At least initially, my answer to the second question was a model of scholarly prudence. The comparison between then and now, I explained, was inherently unfair. Those American statesmen present at the creation enjoyed the overwhelming advantage of being first, which conveyed a retrospective luster and iconic status that no one coming after could easily match. And once you learned something about the presidential election of 1800, which was one of the dirtiest and most controversial in American history, you would be less disposed to regard Adams and Jefferson as canonized political saints, or the founding era as a pristine political paradise. While historically correct, this answer proved wholly unsatisfying to most audiences, who seemed determined to regard the founding generation as the gold standard and our contemporary political leaders as a comparatively debased currency. Eventually, I decided to play to their prejudices by paraphrasing a relevant observation from Henry Adams. "If you reviewed all the American presidents panoramically," Adams joked, "then you were obliged to conclude that Darwin got it exactly backward." As a rhetorical tactic, my response was a resounding success, ending the inquiry with a punchline that foreclosed further conversation. But intellectually, my answer was only a clever finesse that provided no explanation whatsoever for the creative achievement of the founding generation, except its privileged location at the start of the national story. And even though I was at pains to warn against any depiction of the founders as a group of demigods, my response permitted the mythical rendition of the founding era to persist as a once-upon-a-time location in the misty past, sometime before the fall. Left unanswered, even unasked, was the obvious question. If you believed that the last quarter of the 18th century has stood the test of time as the most politically creative chapter in American history, and if you declared inadmissible any explanation for this creative moment that depended upon divine intervention, then what besides dumb luck can account for the achievement that was the American founding? Put simply, how did the American founding happen? This book represents my attempt to answer that question. Early on, I decided that the answer was multi-sided, that no singular definition of political creativity could suffice, and that the biblical definition, to make something out of nothing, was entirely inappropriate. My approach, similar to that taken in Founding Brothers, was to assume that narrative is the highest form of historical analysis, that by inhabiting certain propitious moments and telling their stories, I stood the greatest chance of encountering and hunting down my quarry. Later on, I discovered that some of the stories I had chosen to tell were as much about failure as success, in part because some of the problems facing the founders were insoluble, in part because some problems did not call out their fullest creative energies. Irony was also at work, meaning that impressive resolutions of some problems closed off options to solve others. By circumscribing federal power, especially at the executive level, for example, The founders placed the threat of despotism on the permanent defensive, but in so doing, made it virtually impossible to end slavery or reach a just accommodation with the Native Americans. This is a story, then, about tragedy as well as triumph, indeed about their mutual and inextricable coexistence. I come away from it still believing that the gathering of political talent at this historical moment is unlikely ever to be surpassed, which I suppose means that the Henry Adams quip, though wickedly mischievous, is not wholly unfair. But I also come away with a more chastened sense of celebration, periodically wishing that the founders had been demigods who could perform miracles. Then I catch myself and realize that, if flawless, they would have nothing to teach us. And they do. Prologue. The Founding. During the last quarter of the 18th century, a former colony of Great Britain, generally regarded as a provincial and wholly peripheral outpost of Western civilization, somehow managed to establish a set of ideas and institutions that, over the stretch of time, became the blueprint for political and economic success for the nation-state in the modern world. Over the course of the next two centuries, these ideas and institutions, labeled democracy or liberalism, though neither term would have been recognizable to the founding generation, replaced the monarchical dynasties of Europe in the 19th century, then defeated the totalitarian despotisms of Germany, Japan, and the Soviet Union in the 20th. Before we embark on the stories that follow, we need at least to glimpse the contours of the larger story, which is about the triumph of representative government bottomed on the principle of popular sovereignty. A market economy fueled by the energies of unfettered citizens, a secular state unaffiliated with any official religion, and the rule of law that presumed the equality of all citizens. What seemed so brazen and improbable at the time has become the accepted global formula for national success. The only alternative, apart from North Korea's and Cuba's last stand versions of communism, is Islamic fundamentalism, and its essentially medieval values appear to be fighting a desperate rearguard action against modernity itself. The first enduring version of political modernity made its initial appearance in the United States during the Revolutionary era. The most prominent revolutionary of all, George Washington, offered the first comprehensive explanation for this stunning achievement. And, rather interestingly, he chose to emphasize the fortuitous conjunction of large-scale historical forces beyond human control, rather than the actions or decisions of men. In Washington's formulation, written in 1783, even before the full story had played out, the American Revolution enjoyed two incalculable advantages: time, or perhaps timing, and space. The foundation of our empire was not laid in the gloomy age of ignorance and suspicion, he wrote, but at an epoch when the rights of mankind were better understood and more clearly defined than at any former period. Over the preceding two centuries, a number of English, Scottish, and French thinkers had generated a veritable treasure trove of political knowledge that undermined the medieval worldview about government, society, and even human nature itself. The American people were the beneficiaries of this accumulated wisdom. It had yet to be called the Enlightenment, which had its origins in Europe, but was now destined to enjoy its fullest implementation in America. In effect, history had handed the American revolutionaries a blueprint for a new kind of political architecture that did not need to be discovered or invented, only applied. At this auspicious period, Washington intoned, the United States came into existence as a nation, and if their citizens should not be completely free and happy, the fault will be entirely their own. The second providential advantage was space. Washington was not referring to the distance from predatory European powers provided by the Atlantic Ocean, though on other occasions he did describe that geographic fact as a priceless asset. He was referring instead to the almost limitless resources of the North American continent. The citizens of America, placed in the most enviable condition as the sole lords and proprietors of a vast tract of continent, comprehending all the various soils and climates of the world, and abounding with all the necessaries and conveniences of life, are now, by the late satisfactory pacification, acknowledged to be possessed of absolute freedom and independency. They are, from this period, to be considered as the actors on a most conspicuous theater, which seems to be peculiarly designated by Providence for the display of human greatness and felicity. It was a dazzlingly prophetic statement, especially since the western border at the time was the Mississippi, not the Pacific, and no one really knew what natural resources lay out there for future development and cultivation. But the key insight was that the American Republic began with physical and economic assets, as well as a rich intellectual legacy of enlightened ideas. It could afford to make mistakes, as it inevitably would, because the sheer potential of the continent would rescue and redeem blunders that would have proved fatal in a more constricted European context. For example, the sale of Western lands would bolster federal revenues sufficiently to make taxes unnecessary for the foreseeable future. Though Republican values were inherently opposed to all aristocratic legacies, the United States began with the largest trust fund of any emerging nation in recorded history. Even Washington's explanation of the historical prerequisites for American political success acknowledged that the achievement, no matter how handsomely endowed, would depend on the adroit management of the advantages bestowed by history and geography. No matter how strong a hand had been dealt the revolutionary generation, it had to be played deftly. And if misplayed, all the advantages would collapse into a pile of humiliation and failure. This is what Abraham Lincoln meant 80 years later at Gettysburg, when he said that no one was quite sure whether, in the absence of imaginative leadership, a government so conceived and so dedicated can long endure. One of Washington's most distinguished contemporaries warned, however, that any shift in focus from emphasizing the historical conditions underlying the American achievement to insisting on the decisive role of prominent personalities ran major risks of distortion. John Adams sensed this shift happening in the first decade of the 19th century as he looked back at the history he had lived from his retirement perch at Quincy and compared his own memories with the histories already beginning to appear. In a characteristically candid and extraordinarily colorful correspondence with Benjamin Rush, his longtime friend and fellow revolutionary, a correspondence that even featured reports on their respective dreams, Adams warned that the emphasis on personalities and what historians now call agency was all wrong. Rush actually put it most succinctly. "I shall continue to believe that great men are a lie," he observed, "and that there is very little difference in that superstition which leads us to believe in what the world calls great men and in that which leads us to believe in witches and conjurers." Adams heartily concurred. "The feasts and funerals in honor of Washington is as corrupt a system as that by which saints were canonized and cardinals, popes, and whole hierarchical systems created." Adams had known and worked alongside Washington for 25 years and could testify that His Excellency himself would object to "the pilgrimages to Mount Vernon as the new Mecca or Jerusalem, in an effort to display his own.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.